Damn it.
Poor Joe, just when he was getting to the best part of the video, the network unfortunately cuts out. All of this could have been avoided if he had a little bit more knowledge about network topologies. Fortunately for you, we are going to teach you just what are network topologies so that you can avoid suffering a fate similar to Joe's.
Wait, what are network topologies?
Network topologies are defined as the structure of the network of how all computers are interconnected to each other.
Oh wow, that's a quite detailed explanation. Who taught you that?
Wikipedia. Anyways, there are 7 different types of topologies, and they are bus, ring, star, mesh, tree, hybrid, and last but not least, P2P. I don't know why it's known as point to point.
But how do I know which one suits best for me?
I don't know, but that's what we are going to find out today. Firstly, we'll be talking about bus topologies. A bus topology is when a single computer acts as a server for all computers. There will be a single cable acting as a spine, which connects all nodes together. If there are 2 endpoints, it is labeled as a linear bus topology.
What makes a bus topology unique to other topologies?
Well, advantages of bus topologies are that they are inexpensive and easy to install. The structure makes them ideal for small networks, and they only listen for data being sent from the server and are incapable of moving data from one computer to another. But with every advantage, there is a disadvantage. And in the case of bus topologies, if the common cable fails, the whole system will crash. If there is a heavy load, it will cause a collision in the network and also reduce its performance. Having said that, bus topologies are normally used in cyber cafes and school computer labs when there is a need for instant access and monitoring of multiple computers from one computer.
Well, it's definitely not ideal for one person use. So let's move on to...
Up next, we have ring topology. Ring topologies are when computers are connected in such a way that there are always 2 neighboring computers for communications. Data is transferred from one computer to another using tokens. Advantages of ring topologies are that they are easy to install and configure. Removing a device won't disrupt the whole connection. There is equal access to all computers, and it is faster to check for errors in the ring topology. The disadvantages include the risk of the whole network breaking if one ring breaks. It has a high power consumption due to constant signal circulation, and it is difficult to troubleshoot, and removing computers can disturb the network activity.
Maybe I can change my network topology to ring and propose to my girlfriend.
Oh my god. Moving on. A point-to-point topology is a network connection consisting of direct links between all computers. It is also considered the easiest topology. Because of the direct links, point-to-point topologies have fast and reliable connections. They do not need dedicated network operating software, expensive servers, and individual workstations are used to access files. They also do not need dedicated network technicians. But its configuration style also makes it unable to back up files centrally, have a proper security system other than permissions, and work in large areas.
Bruh, I'm guessing this is probably what hackers want people to use.
I don't see why not. Star topologies are when all computers are connected together with the help of a hub. This cable is called the central node, and all other nodes are connected through the central node. It is most popular among LAN networks, as it is easy and inexpensive to install. Star topologies are easy to troubleshoot, modify, and set up. One failed node does not affect the rest. It has fast performance with a few nodes and a very low network traffic. Addition, deletion, and moving of devices is easy when you are using a star topology. The star topologies aren't stars at everything though. If a hub fails, attached nodes are disabled. It is also very expensive. heavy traffic can slow it considerably. Performance heavily depends on bus capacity, and a damaged cable can bring the whole network down.
Yikes! I wouldn't be the star of my show at my disposal.
Now, for mesh topologies, there are two variations. A partial mesh, where some devices are connected to two or three devices, and a full mesh, where every node is connected to each other. Advantages of mesh topologies are that they can be expanded without disrupting current users, are extra capable compared to other topologies, there is no traffic problem as nodes have dedicated links. Mesh topologies are robust, and they also have multiple links preventing data blockages. They have an easy fault identification process, and they can avoid chances of network failures by connecting all systems to a central node, and every system has its privacy and security.
Wow, that's a lot of advantages.
Yup, but wait till you hear about the disadvantages. Due to its structure, installation is expensive and complex, and due to the number of cables needed to connect, every node has a complicated implementation. It takes up more space due to dedicated links, and the amount of cabling requires large space.
Wow, that's a lot of disadvantages.
Tree topologies have a root node, and all other nodes are connected in the form of hierarchy. It is very common to a bus and star topology, as it integrated multiple star topologies in a single bus. Its advantages are that the node expansion is fast and easy. One failure does not affect the rest of the network. Error detection is easy, and management is also easy. Hand in hand, the disadvantages are that it is heavily cabled, and the adding of more nodes makes maintenance more difficult. And if the hub fails, attached nodes are also disabled.
I wonder if I make more tree topologies, will I reduce my carbon footprint?
No, you will be doing the opposite. Hybrid topologies, as the name suggests, is when two or more topologies are combined to form an infrastructure. An example of this is shown above, when a star topology and a point-to-point topology is combined. Advantages are that it offers the easiest method for troubleshooting. It is effective and has a flexible network topology, and is also scalable, so you can increase your network size. The disadvantages are that it is super complex and also the most costliest.
I guess the perfect breed hasn't been made yet.
Oh, so after all of my information, you've ran out of space to store it on your computer? Well, allow me to introduce you to cloud computing. Now, cloud computing, according to Google, is the practice of using a network of remote servers hosted on the internet to store, manage, and process data, rather than a local server or a personal computer. There are four main types of cloud computing: private clouds, public clouds, hybrid clouds, and multi-clouds. There are also three main types of cloud computing services, which are infrastructure as a service, or IaaS, platform as a service, or PaaS, and software as a service, or SaaS. Public clouds are cloud environments, typically created from IT infrastructure, not owned by the end user. Some of the largest public cloud providers include Alibaba Cloud, Amazon Web Services, Google Cloud, IBM Cloud, and Microsoft Azure. All clouds become public clouds when the environments are partitioned and redistributed to multiple tenants. Fee structures aren't necessary characteristics of public clouds anymore, since some cloud providers, like the Massachusetts Open Cloud, allow tenants to use their clouds for free. Private clouds are loosely defined as cloud environments solely dedicated to a single end user or group, where the environment usually runs behind that user or group's firewall. All clouds become private clouds when the underlying IT infrastructure is dedicated to a single customer with completely isolated access. A hybrid cloud is a seemingly single IT environment created from multiple environments connected through local area networks, wide area networks, and virtual private networks, and/or APIs. The characteristics of hybrid clouds are complex, and the requirements can differ depending on whom you ask. For example, a hybrid cloud may need to include at least one private cloud and at least one public cloud, two or more public clouds, two or more private clouds, and a bare metal or virtual environment connected to at least one public cloud or private cloud. Multi-clouds are a cloud approach made up of more than one cloud service for more than one cloud vendor, public or private. All hybrid clouds are multi-clouds, but not all multi-clouds are hybrid clouds. Multi-clouds become hybrid clouds when multiple clouds are connected by some form of integration or orchestration. So, what about cloud services? We'll begin with IaaS. IaaS means a cloud service provider manages the infrastructure for you, thus the name infrastructure as a service. The actual servers, network, virtualization, and data storage through an internet connection. The user has access through an API or dashboard and essentially runs the infrastructure. The user manages things like the operating system, apps, and middleware, while the provider takes care of any hardware, networking, hard drives, data storage, and servers, and has the responsibility of taking care of outages, repairs, hardware issues. This is typical deployment of cloud storage providers. Up next, we have PaaS, which means the hardware and the application software platform are provided, managed by an outside cloud service provider, but the user handles the apps running on top of the platform and the data the app relies on, thus the name platform as a service. Primarily, it's used for developers and programmers. PaaS gives users a shared cloud platform for application development and management without having to build and maintain the infrastructure usually associated with the process. SaaS is a service that delivers a software application which the cloud service provider manages to its users, thus the name software as a service. Typically, SaaS apps and web applications or mobile apps that users can access via a web browser. Software updates, bug fixes, and other general software maintenance are taken care of for the user, and they connect to the cloud applications via a dashboard or API. SaaS also eliminates the need to have an app installed locally on each individual's user computer, allowing greater methods of group or team access to the software. So, whether you work in a business or not, you might be thinking whether you want to implement cloud computing into your normal life. But it is important to realize its advantages and disadvantages. Some advantages include, number one, backup and restore data. The second one is it has improved collaboration. The third, it has excellent accessibility. And the fourth, it has low maintenance costs. Number five, it's mobile. Number six, iServices in the pay-per-use model, which means cloud computing offers application program interfaces, APIs, to the users for access services on the cloud and pays the charges as per the usage of service. It also has unlimited storage capacity, which is its 7th benefit, and it is also a good data security, which is its 8th benefit. Some of the disadvantages of cloud computing are, when you have a bad internet connectivity, it will take too long to access some data, which makes cloud computing a pain. The second one will be vendor lock-in. Vendor lock-in is the biggest disadvantage of cloud computing. Organizations may face problems when transferring their services from one vendor to another, as different vendors provide different platforms that can cause difficulty moving from one cloud to another. A third one would be limited control. Cloud infrastructure is completely owned, managed, and monitored by the service provider, so the cloud users have less control over the function and execution of services within the cloud structure. Security is also a disadvantage. Although cloud service providers implement the best security standards to store important information, but before adopting cloud technology, you should be aware that you will be sending all your organization's sensitive information to a third party, for example, a cloud computing service provider. While sending the data on the cloud, there may be a chance that your organization's information is hacked by the hackers.
Okay, that's it. That's all we have for this presentation video. My name is not Joe, by the way. Thanks.